Children, you are hope for justice. Stand firm in the truth now. Set your hearts above. You will be
My name is Andrew, and it is so good to be with you today. Now, it might be possible that you have a room at your house that looks just like this. Maybe it's your attic, maybe it's your garage, or a crawl space, or something. And we have an opportunity for you to do something about that that will serve our church. At the end of this month, on Saturday, February the 27th, we are going to be having a church-wide yard sale in the Family Life Center. For the small price of $25 plus 10% of what you sell, you will get a spot in the Family Life Center to sell your things to make money for you. There's really no strings attached. The money that we raise will be a fundraiser for our youth activities that are going on this year. So it might be possible that now is the perfect chance for you to go through and get rid of some of that stuff that is taking so much space in your home. We would love to use this as an opportunity to help you and to help our youth out this year. Again, that's on Saturday, February the 27th. If you would like to register for that as a seller, you can call the church office at any time. The number is right up here on the screen. Or you can go to the website that's right up here on the screen now, and you can just give us some information so that we can put you down for that. And then, of course, if you want to come and peruse and purchase things, you can do that on the 27th from 7 a.m. until 12. And as much as possible, we would love for you to help us get the word out about that. Now, we have another big thing coming up next Sunday afternoon. Now, right now, we're in the middle of an emphasis called I Heart Savannah. You know, it's our church-wide emphasis on spreading the love of Jesus to people in our community. No strings attached. And next Sunday, we're going to be doing the first part of that called Pray and Go. And that's going to happen on next Sunday afternoon. More times and specific locations will be available to you next week. And here's how this is going to work. We're all going to meet here at the church on Sunday afternoon, and we're going to simply do two things. We're going to pray, and we're going to go. So if you can walk around a neighborhood, and if you can pray for people, you got everything that you need to join with us. We would love to see as many people as possible doing this as a church. We're going to be doing it next Sunday, and we're going to be doing it the following Sunday, and then we'll do it a couple more weeks later on in a few months. And we would love for you to join with us. We are so glad that each and every single one of you is here with us right now, and we would love to connect with you. We'll have more information about that later on in our service, but for now, it's good to be with you.
Well, good morning, church. It is good to be here today in the Lord's house, and we invite you to stand and join in singing with us our first song this morning, His Mercy Is More. Let's sing together.
What love could remember the wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood in the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn.
Glad that His mercies are greater than our sin. You may be seated. And it is good to welcome you to Emmanuel Baptist Church this morning. We're glad that you have joined us here in person. I know it's a rainy day, outside and inside. We are working on addressing that, but just trying to keep the carpets dry and those kinds of things, and pay it no matter and no attention, and it'll be just fine, all right? But we are glad that you're here with us today, and if there are any guests or visitors here with us this morning, we say welcome to you. We're glad that you've joined us for this special worship service today and time of communion that we'll be sharing in later on in the service. For those of you who are viewing at home, we're glad that you have tuned in. In that way, we'd like to just let you know that we will be doing communion later on in the service. So if you have some things there at your home to gather up, some bread and some juice perhaps, you might want to go ahead and get those out and be ready to participate with us when that time comes in the service. And we'd like to say thank you for joining with us this morning. And if you would, just let us know that you're there. We would appreciate just any comments that you would like to make and share in that section online. Also, if you're a guest or tuning in for the first time, we'd love to know that as well. On the screen, you can see the information of how to get through our website, ibcsav.com/welcome. And we would just like to be able to follow up with you and thank you for being a part of our worship service today. Let us go to the Lord in prayer as we continue in our time of worship this morning. Would you join me? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for your great love and for the mercies that are new every morning that we just sang about, Lord. And we're just so grateful for the love of Christ and for his willingness to go to the cross to pay for our sin. And Lord, just throughout this service this morning, I just pray that you continually impress upon our hearts the great love that you have for us. And Lord, we worship you and we thank you and we give you all the praise and the honor and the glory. It is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, in the book of Colossians, we find these words, chapter 1, verses 15 through 20. He, being Jesus Christ, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, because by him everything was created in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and by him all things hold together. He is also the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile everything unto himself, by making peace through the blood of his cross, whether things on earth or things in heaven. And what a great mystery that is, that Jesus Christ would set aside the throne and the crown that he had in heaven, and would come to earth and live as a man to die on a cross for our sins. Let's stand together once again as we sing this new hymn, Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery.
The theme of heaven's praises
be seated. Like shadows on a hill, darkness was awakened by a hammer's ring, by a suffering king.
Sorrow ruled the day, a savior would be broken by the sting of death. He'd take his final breath.
Just when all our hopes seemed lost, the earth began to move. For in that moment, heaven's love broke through. 'Cause he went the distance, he found a way. Mercy's persistence drew him to the cross where he would save. And all such debt of grace he chose to pay for all my sin.
Such debt of grace he chose to pay so love could win.
If he can hang the stars, then he can shine the light of grace to where
send his healing waters
to bring you peace,
to bring you peace.
If he can save the sinner's heart, and I'm the living proof,
there's no valley where he
sing one more song together just before Pastor Lane comes this morning, the hymn At the Cross.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he
is now an appropriate time for me to mention that the church is selling Emmanuel golf umbrellas. Is now a good time to talk about that? It might be a smart time. I'm not sure if it's an appropriate time, but whatever the case may be, I appreciate you braving the elements to be out here today. It's kind of interesting because last week I think we had the largest attendance that we've had at a regular church service in about a year, in almost a year. And then, of course, you know, today is all messy, and so kind of keeps a lot of folks away. I did notice that that our numbers on Facebook Live are up, and so glad that you're joining us on there. And again, I would encourage you, as you can see here, we'll be celebrating the elements this morning, and so you may want to run and grab some crackers and some juice there at the house. Today, important day. It's Valentine's Day, right? You like my red sweater? Had to celebrate, you know, had to represent. And you may have already expressed your love to your significant other in some form or fashion. You know, that's kind of what you do on Valentine's. I know some people went out to eat last night, yesterday, and you know, kind of went ahead and got a jump on things. And maybe you got your sweetie a little gift, right? Maybe you got some flowers or some candy. People brought me some, Martha brought me some candy, brought my favorite candy today. Maybe you went and bought something for your loved one. Maybe you got, it could be something big, you know, like around Christmas time, you've seen those commercials, the December to Remember, and they walk out and they've given each other brand new Lexuses, you know. Do people really do that? I mean, we're not at that level quite yet to be able to go buy two Lexus. Is it Lexi? I don't know what Lexus is at the same time. Maybe you did that. Maybe you bought some jewelry for your sweetie to express your love, to show your love. Maybe you just got a card. Maybe that's all you got. Or maybe you're one of those guys who's, you know, your statement is, hey, I told her when we got married that I loved her, and if I change my mind, you know, if I ever change my mind, I'll let her know then. Other than that, I'm not going to tell her I love her. Shame on you if that's you, but maybe that's all you got her for Valentine's Day. You know, there are a lot of different things that we give to express and to show love. Jesus said, greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. That's even bigger than a Lexus, believe it or not. And that's what Jesus did for us. I want to encourage you to turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 22. And I want to talk to you about these elements that we are going to be partaking in just a few moments. Luke chapter, I almost said Lexus, chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, beginning in verse 14. I want you to read along with me, if you will. When the hour had come, he, meaning Jesus, reclined at the table. We had talked about this back in the spring. Reclining was a little bit different than what we think of. When we talk about reclining, we get in our favorite chair and it kind of leans back. We pop our feet up and we lay back and we make an attempt to watch TV, to which we will probably fall asleep before that show is finished. That's not the kind of reclining that they did. They didn't sit at a table. We have different pictures of what it was probably like for Jesus and his apostles to be around that table. You know, we've got the Da Vinci painting, and they're all sitting around that table. And it's a beautiful painting. It's just absolutely wrong. It's nothing like what reality was, because reclining for them was more like lying down with your head at the table and your feet behind you, and you may have been resting on both elbows or on one elbow kind of on the side. That's what reclining was. That's how they all sat around that table, and the apostles were with him. And in verse 15, he said to them, I have earnestly desire. I mean, I've really wanted this, to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall never again eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes. And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. For behold, the hand of the one betraying me is with mine on the table. For indeed, the Son of Man is going as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. And they began to discuss among themselves which one of them it might be who was going to do this thing. I want to talk to you about the three main meals. I don't mean breakfast, lunch, and dinner, or breakfast, dinner, supper. I don't know how you say it. Everybody says it a little bit different. Not those three. And I'm not talking about the three best meals. Maybe your best meal you ever had was something that your mama cooked. Maybe that your wife cooked, or maybe it was something that, I don't know, Paula Deen cooked. You know, you went out to eat and you remember a great, great meal that you had had. I want to talk to you about the three best meals in all of history. And those were mentioned, they're all represented right here in this passage that we just read. And really, we can pinpoint those in just a couple of verses. If you back up to verse 15, he says, I have earnestly desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I shall never eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. There are three meals that he has just referenced. The greatest meals in all of history. The first is what they were there to celebrate, and that is the Passover meal. They would celebrate Passover every year, and of course it was a remembrance of something that was a great turning point in the life of God's people. And so the Israelites made a point to signify that and to celebrate that through a simple meal. And that's what the Passover was all about. The Passover is a message to God's people. It is a remembrance to God's people that God delivers. That God delivers through judgment of sin, oddly enough, by the death of a substitute. That's what Passover is all about. God delivers. And he does it through judgment. But he judges through a substitute. Now, the Passover was a carefully ordered meal every single year. It was a ritual that they would carry out. And every part of that meal had special significance, had some kind of a reminder of the redemption of God's people from Israel, I mean from Egypt. And each one of the parts of that meal would point to something that was meaningful to God's people. The Passover lamb reminded them of the blood of the lamb that was smeared on the doorposts in order to escape the visitation of the angel of death. That was that substitute. The unleavened bread, we talk about the bread this is definitely not unleavened bread. It looks pretty, but it's not unleavened bread. What you're going to have in here, many of you have had this before, and you know that this is not exactly pleasant. But that's how unleavened bread was. It was not really that pleasant. But even unleavened bread, they didn't just want to torture themselves. It was a reminder. It was a reminder that they didn't have time to cook bread in the normal way. In other words, the redemption was coming swiftly, and they had no time to bake bread in the normal, ordinary way. That's what the unleavened bread was about. There was a bowl of salt water, and it reminded them of the tears of their captivity. The bitter herbs that they had, and one day we're going to have a Seder dinner here, and you're gonna experience and taste those bitter herbs. But those bitter herbs reminded them of the bitterness of their slavery, which makes it all the more odd that when they were complaining, as we talked about, we've been talking about on Wednesday Night Live, if you haven't been able to be there, that they wanted to go back into slavery. And yet, it was to remind them of how bitter slavery was. There was a paste that was a part of this meal, and it was to remind them of the clay of the bricks that they had to use to build their homes during their bondage. And then there were four cups of wine, new wine, that they would drink at these meals, and it was to remind them of the four promises found in Exodus chapter 6. You can turn there if you have time. If you don't, you may just want to write that down. Exodus chapter 6, verses 6 and 7 give four promises, and it says this: "Say therefore to the sons of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will deliver you from their bondage. I will also redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. Then I will take you for my people, and I will be your God. And you shall know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians." This was the ritual part of the Passover meal. And it was to remind them that God had delivered them, and so they celebrated that every year. It was a watershed moment in the life of God's people. And so even Jesus, when he came, he would celebrate this Passover meal with them. That was meal number one. Meal number two that we celebrate here is actually what we are celebrating, and that is the Lord's Supper. You see, the Passover meal has passed on. It has bypassed because it has been fulfilled in Jesus. Therefore, we celebrate the Lord's Supper. And what Jesus did was, is he took all of these elements, all of these teachings that surrounded the Passover, and he began to make new application for those things. You see, when they would celebrate the Passover meal, at the end of that meal, someone would ask, and it was usually appointed as to the youngest son, would ask this question: why is this night different from other nights? Why the Passover? Why every year do we do this? What is different about tonight than all the other nights? And then the host of the meal, and in this case it would have been Jesus, the host of the meal would go through and talk about the Passover story and tell them about the angel of death and how God passed them over, and then how God would release them and deliver them from captivity out of Egypt. And the story would tell of, first of all, of God's remembrance of his covenant. And so as Jesus was covering the story of that covenant, he reminded them, this is the new covenant. The story of the Exodus would then take on the story of the deliverance from slavery in Egypt. And Jesus would apply this meal, and he would say that this is for the forgiveness of sins. And then he would talk about the blood of the Passover lamb. And at the Last Supper, Jesus said, this is my blood. And then there would be the interpretation of the elements of the Passover meal, what each one of them meant. And so Jesus took it and he said, this is my body and this is my blood. So that now the Passover meal has become the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper, and it all points toward him. That's the second greatest meal in all of history. And then the third greatest meal is yet to come. And Jesus makes reference to that when he says, I will not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. So that Jesus has not partaken of the Passover. He's not remembered this, but one day he's going to bring it to its greatest fulfillment. And I don't know how it can get any better than it is now. I don't know how it can get more illustrative than it is right now, how much more meaningful it can be than it is right now, but it will be, because Jesus says, in its fulfillment, in its greatest fulfillment, it is yet to come. And that is referenced for us back, all the way back to the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 19, and in our study of the end times, we didn't cover this in great depth, but Revelation chapter 19, beginning in verse 5, again, you can turn there or you can make reference to it, says, "And a voice came from the throne saying, 'Give praise to our God, all you his bondservants, you who fear him, the small and the great.' Then I heard something like the voice of a great multitude, and like the sound of many waters, and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, saying, 'Alleluia, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give the glory to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was given her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints.' Then he said to me, 'Write, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb.' And he said to me, 'These are true words of God.' And what other choice did he have? John says, 'Then I fell at his feet to worship him.' But he said to me, 'Don't do that. I am a fellow servant of yours and your brethren who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy.'" You see, the greatest supper in all of history is yet to come. Think about the greatest meal you've ever had, and you ain't seen nothing yet. The marriage supper of the Lamb is yet to come. But I do want to point out, he said, blessed are those who are invited to that marriage supper. Those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. You see, this supper won't be for everyone throughout all of history. Only those who have received Christ as Savior and as Lord will be invited to this supper. They're the only ones who will be able to attend. They're only ones who will be able to enjoy and be able to look at the Lamb and say, blessed are you, alleluia, to the Lamb of God. And be able to look back at all that has taken place throughout all of history and see the significance and how it has been fulfilled in Jesus and in Jesus alone. That's why this right here, as Paul instructed to the church at Corinthians, to the church at Corinth, he told them, he said, listen, don't play around with this. This is only for believers. And those are the only ones who will be accepted and invited to that great supper to come. So, as we begin prepare to partake of the elements here today, I would ask you, has there been a time in your life where you have repented of your sin? Acknowledge your sin before God. Acknowledge that he is the only hope for you. Believe in his death and burial and resurrection on your behalf. He is the substitute for your sin. And has there been a time where you have placed your faith and trust in him? And if there has, hallelujah, you get to once again glorify his name by celebrating this as he told us to. But if not, I would implore you, take a moment now, call out to him, and receive him as Savior and Lord. Right there where you are, right in here where you are, right in there in your seat. God, I repent of my sin. I believe that you rose from the dead, that you died for my sins, and that you rose again on the third day, and I receive you as Savior and as Lord here right now. Then one day, you'll be invited to that great supper. And for right now, you'll be able to participate in this. But make sure that you are of the faith. Now, as we go to a time where we celebrate this particular supper the way that he has intended for us to, this second supper that we covered, I want to assure anyone who is a guest with us, whether online or here in person, that we do practice what we call open communion. Open communion simply means that there are some churches who insist on what we would call closed communion. Closed communion is where only people within that church, only members of that church, are invited to participate in the Lord's Supper with them. We practice open communion, which simply means that you don't have to be a member of this church. Now, that doesn't mean that it's open to just anyone. As I mentioned just a second ago, if you're not a believer, if you're not a follower of Jesus Christ, I would encourage you to not participate in this because of the warnings that are given to us by Paul in 1 Corinthians. But if you're a believer, if you're a follower in Jesus Christ, you don't have to be a member of this church in order to participate in this with us. Now, once again, just for the sake of clarity, to make sure that you understand this, because not everybody has done this with us yet, we have these singular units of the elements. The top layer is just a thin clear layer, and once you peel that back, you have access to the wafer there. And then you can peel the rest of it back the way that you would other items that are along the same lines, and you peel the rest of it back, and that exposes the juice for you. And the way that we'd like to do this, in order to do this in a in an orderly manner, is that I would invite the head of household to come down. In other words, if you're single, you're head of household. If you're head of household, would invite you to come down and get enough for your family. If there's someone who is around you that maybe they're not able to move, you may want to offer to get theirs for them. But we'll do it by section and invite you to come down and get that for your household. Take it back, and then we will celebrate those elements together. Now, again, we invite you to come down here to get this, because we're not going to pass these plates as we have been practicing here lately. I believe that's all the instruction that I need to give on that particular matter. Let's go to God in prayer as we prepare our hearts for this time. God, on this Valentine's Day, when love is the topic, I don't know that there is anything, any greater example of love that we could talk about than your sacrifice for us. The perfect, sinless one, unblemished, who would come as a substitute for us and take our sin upon yourself. The very ones who offended you, and the one who is right to be offended, and the one who is offended comes and takes the place of the offender. What a remarkable truth that is. Almost to the point of being unbelievable, because we just don't see that in our own human flesh. God, we owe you everything. And so when you ask us to remember you and what you have done in this way, it's a no-brainer. And so we come to celebrate, we come to thank you, we come to recommit, and may all of those take place here as we partake of these elements. And Lord, I pray for those who don't know you, those who are not followers of yours. God, may they take stock of their lives, may they take stock of their eternity, and may they rethink their position, and may they yield to you. May the Holy Spirit of conviction fall upon them, and may the assurance of your love and your capability in saving them shine through into their hearts, soften their hearts, and may they repent and find salvation that's found only in you. And for those of us who have, we go back to that day where we repented. We go back to that day where we received you. And we relive that, and we do so in thankfulness and in love and devotion to you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to invite the head of household here, head of household in this section here. Up in the balcony, there is a table up here where the elements are found. Y'all are welcome to come down here if you'd like, but you can make your way to the table up there if you'd like. invite those in this section. In this section, if you'd like to make your way down. As we have read, Jesus took that bread and he pointed to his own body that would be broken for us as the great sacrifice. The Bible says that he prayed as after he broke that bread. And so, Clayton, I'm going to ask if you would, right where you are, if you'd just stand and lead us in prayer at this time, I'd appreciate that. He said, take and eat. Then in like manner, he held up that juice and he said, this is my blood. The Bible says that he also prayed over this as well. Mark, I'm going to ask you, if you would pray for us at this time in our service. Take and drink. God, there is absolutely no way that we could spin things to where we deserve what you did for us. We can't explain it. There's no excuse for it. We simply don't deserve it. And yet you so willingly gave yourself. God, may our heart's devotion always be turned toward you. We thank you for the forgiveness of sin, the cleansing that is found therein. And that if we will confess our sin, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. As the song says, whiter than snow. We thank you for that assurance. And I pray for the person in the sound of my voice that maybe feeling dirty and unclean and unlovable and guilty. We thank you that your word informs us and encourages us that because of Jesus, we are found not guilty, that we are indeed lovable, and that we can be clean. What a marvelous concept. And I also pray for the person who walks through this mindlessly and does not consider all that you have done for us, walks through it like a ritual without thought. God, forgive. God, open eyes to the marvelous truth of what you've done for us. And we thank you for times like this where we can remember. And may it be an encouragement to us throughout this week so that every moment, every decision, every thought, every word is held captive to you and your lordship. Not out of religious duty, but out of grateful love. May that be our hearts. May we reflect you well. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we close our service, let's stand together and sing this song, Amazing Love. You are my King.
My joy to all.